good evening, and welcome to another episode of GoGTS Live, the Hobbies web show. Thank you for joining us this evening. This is Season 3, Episode 14, our 86th episode. And I know, can you believe that? Love Grin at Watch the Breaks on Twitter. I'm Rob Bertrand at VOTC, Voice of the Collector. And we've got a fun show for you guys planned tonight. We're going to bring on Matt Rogers in a little bit. Matt is the Associate Product Development Manager for Upper Deck Entertainment Products, which is cool because we've certainly been breaking a lot of them lately. We have another one to look at tonight. And I imagine hopefully next week we'll get a look at Black Panther, ooh, which just came out. In addition to that, we got a few other breaks to do. We'll take a look at Hot in the Shop, Hobby Happenings, and much more. But to kick things off, I wanted to give a shout-out to our guys over at Buck City Breaks. They've got a very, very cool event going on this Saturday. They're giving away spots in a break of Panini Plate and Patches football. And they've been kind enough to award us two free spots to give away to our audience. So be sure to look for the tweet on the GoGTS Live Twitter feed. Retweet that. Be sure to follow Buck City Breaks. And then head over to BreakerCulture.com and be sure to give them some love with a good review. Real good people, and we appreciate the opportunity they've provided to give you guys, our audience, two free spots in that break.
Sorry, Rob.
In addition,
I was a little intentional. I was watching you. I was giving him some good radio there. But I did want.
No, you missed your chance. In addition, we've got the GoGTS Live Q of the Week poll going on, and Ivan, I'll need you to provide us some current standings on this. We've got four choices for what currently has more of your interest. Your choices: NHL playoffs, NBA playoffs, Major League Baseball, or when's NFL football start?
Well, Rob, I'm trying
where
to find the
where
right
are people
now,
weighing in at,
it's always
Ivan.
Tough because it gets posted in the beginning of the day, and there's so much great hobby news and updates that get posted there. But of the four current sports listed, well, three current sports and the one that people are anticipating, NBA playoffs, NHL playoffs, Major League Baseball playoffs, and when does NFL start? Well, Rob, Major League Baseball, with over 100 votes in, Major League Baseball is creaming the competition at 38%.
Interesting.
Now, do you care to venture a guess what is second behind that?
Well, I have it right here in front of me, and I'm really happy to see that it is the NHL playoffs, because it's been an absolutely great story for the most part. I am just amazed at the run that the Las Vegas Knights have been on. I mean, it's not right. It's not even fair that an expansion franchise in their first year has advanced this far. Like, and it looked like nobody can stop them right now.
Yeah.
So it's going to be really interesting to see what happens in Game 7 tonight between Winnipeg and Nashville and who they will face in the Western Conference Finals.
I hear what you're saying, but I just can't agree, mainly because they became almost instant rivals of our LA Kings, and they put us away. So as much as I know it's a feel-good story, I by default just can't root for them.
I don't even know if it's a feel-good story. I mean, for me, there's a little bit of angst to it. I mean, in the sense that, I don't know. I think the expansion draft rules really were a little too favorable, as it turns out. I mean, come on. You got to suffer and build your franchise like everybody else. I get it. They want them to be somewhat competitive, not cellar dwellers at the start, but it's just been absolutely unbelievable. And, I mean, you've got guys on that team who have made names for themselves that were, you know, barely knowns of on other teams.
Yeah.
So It's interesting to say the least. What I'm really happy about is that the Pittsburgh Penguins lost. It was so nice to see Alexander Ovechkin get over that hump. It's very reminiscent of Jordan over the Bad Boy Pistons back in the day.
I never thought I'd hear Rob Bertrand cheering for a Ruski.
Yeah, I mean, I just those two came up as rookies in the same time, 05-06, mm-hmm. and they just could not for years get over that hump. So I also am a big proponent of, you know, superstars that don't even get a chance to play for the cup. I mean, it's almost heartbreaking for me. It's why, even though I wasn't a Boston fan and, you know, a Chicago fan over an Avalanche fan, but when Ray Bourque won the Stanley Cup, I was just elated for him personally. So one of the best players to ever lace him up. Alexander Ovechkin is a dominant player and certainly deserves a chance to play and raise that cup. So I can't wait for more. I mean, I'm just so glad hockey's not even close to over
yet. The one thing that disappointed me the most about this round was I've never rooted for the plot of sudden death to actually happen more than when San Jose and the Las Vegas Knights were playing, but it did not. So.
No, it did not, did it?
Van Damme versus the Chicken Mascot. Come on.
That's right. You know, I got to find Beckett. The Fat Packs had a really good poll this week, and I wish I could get my fingers on that really quickly.
Well, do you want to take a second and look at it? Because I did want to make just a few quick announcements, if I can.
Yeah, go ahead while I try to pull this up.
The first one is, if you're brand new to the show, I mean, we've already got ridiculous numbers. Thank you, everybody, I'm on Facebook, Twitch, and I'm on Periscope watching right now. Some ridiculous numbers already for the Open tonight. If you're brand new to the show, make sure you follow us on Twitter, twitter.com/GoGTSLive. That's where we end up aggregating all of the stuff for all the giveaways we're going to do, because we've got a bunch of box breaks we're going to do tonight to preview things, and we're going to give away the hits from those box breaks. So make sure you follow us on Twitter. That said, to reiterate your opening point, if you try to talk to me on Twitter tonight, I may not see it because my notifications are blowing up so much from that Buck City Breaks free break spot that they're giving away. Because you're also giving one away at VOTC on Twitter, right, Rob?
Right.
And I'm giving one away at Watch the Breaks, and then GoGTS Live has two to give away. So make sure you retweet those tweets as well and follow those guys and support them. But it was fun. Last week we had a lot of people sending tweets and tagging us and tagging myself and you as well so that we could read them during the show. So do that so that we can stay engaged. We like hearing feedback from you during the show, unless your feedback is that it's buffering too slow. Hit refresh. I know. It doesn't always work. Sometimes it's on our end. I know Facebook, I've seen that tonight. But Periscope is cooking along. Were you able to find that poll?
Shout out to Bayless Fee 21, a new viewer on YouTube. Welcome to GoGTS Live. Yeah, I found that poll that the Fat Packs put up. It said, what price range is the highest price you've ever paid for a single card? And the choices were 1 to 250, 250 to 500, 500 to 5,000. And obviously the majority would fall in the 1 to 250 range, but I was pretty surprised. Out of 185 votes, 14% between 500 and 5,000.
Now, is the poll closed? Is it too late to vote on it? It is.
Yeah, it is closed.
It is, because you know what? Honestly, Rob, so I've literally, the most I've paid is $500.
Was that for a Chris Bryant card, I would imagine?
No, it was not. It was for a Blake Bortles card.
Oh, my gosh.
But, hey, real quick, because I do see also that we have our guest almost ready, but I want to mention one other thing about the Twitter. Right now, our pinned tweet is the live Periscope broadcast. We always have a little special surprise or a little extra giveaway, so make sure that you retweet that to be entered into win our first giveaway. Also, Rob, I know we got into the show just a little late. We don't have anything left over from last week, do we?
I don't think so. All right, we are pleased to be joined on GoGTS Live by Matt Rogers, Associate Product Development Manager for Entertainment Products at Upper Deck. Matt, welcome to GoGTS Live. Thanks for joining us tonight.
Hey, guys. Thanks for having me.
Hey, it's my pleasure. And again, I'm going to make a public apology for the absolute last-minute-ness of this, but the fact that you were able to step in, dude, you're an automatic friend of the program, hey, so thanks a bunch.
No problem.
You guys have been absolutely on fire lately with Marvel products, and the coup that you guys landed with the Netflix license to be able to do products for those franchises is just totally awesome. We got to look at Daredevil when it first came out, and Ivan and I both loved it. We've been breaking Marvel Annual, and got to touch base with you about getting a box to check out of Black Panther soon. But I mean, what's it like on the product development side when you go, my gosh, the MCU is so hot right now, and we get to make trading cards for it? Tell us about that.
Believe it or not, it's actually a lot of fun for me personally. I'm a comic book collector myself. I do a lot of comic book reading. I mean, I got into Marvel probably when I was about, I don't know, maybe 8 or 9 years old. Me being this involved in the Marvel, both the theatrical and television series as well as the comic book realm is... It's phenomenal for me. It's almost like a dream come true.
You're a fanboy like us.
I'm a fan
That's
boy.
Awesome.
I'm a fanboy.
So we got to deviate just a little from the script and find out what was it like. What were your favorite comics from the Marvel Universe when you were young, and what's your favorite movie today?
So I'll answer the second question first. Right, so far, I've seen every Marvel movie that's been released up through Infinity War, obviously. My personal favorite is definitely Civil War. I think that the duplicity or the duality between Captain America and Iron Man, I thought that was fantastic for the entire movie. As far as the comic books go, I mean, my favorite character personally is Colossus, and the book that really got me involved with him as a character and his storyline was Uncanny X-Men 390, which was the issue where he kills himself or in order to cure the legacy virus.
Excellent. So, all right. So we've got the right guy at the helm to be tackling these just coveted franchises and titles. One of the things that I found was a big hit on Netflix was the surprising introduction of Punisher in season 2 of Daredevil, and then the spin-off launch of his own series, which just for me just proved phenomenal. You know, it's been attempted in film and hasn't, you know, quite hit it right, but I think they got it right for Netflix. Can you peel back the curtain at all, or what's going on with the possibility of us looking at a Punisher trading card set?
I will say that there's a possibility of just about anything out there. You know, Daredevil.
Okay.
Daredevil's obviously done a great job for us. You know, I'm real proud of that release that came out. I will say the possibilities are limitless. I think that's the correct term.
Cool. Awesome. Well, coming on the heels, we've got, let's see. So Marvel Annual, Black Panther, and I just got a solicitation. My goodness, today. For X-Men, Fleer Ultra, going back old school 94, 95, even with the old school retro logo. And this is a quick turnaround on the solicitation. I mean, orders are due from distributors really in just a couple weeks here. So what it just surprised me because usually there's a little bit more. I mean, was that on the fence that it might not happen, or why the short turnaround on this?
We had, because of the success of Flare Ultra Spider-Man, we wanted to take that concept and build on it. It's not so much to just simply rewash, rinse, and repeat what has been done in the past. It's better to improve upon. Even though everybody really liked Flare Ultra Spider-Man, I and a lot of the other staff here felt that we could make it better. So a lot of what we wanted to do was to go that extra mile, take that extra step to make it a better product, improve upon it. So the late solicitations, we understand, was not perfectly ideal, But we wanted to make sure we had everything right on the nose before we sent out all the information.
Got it. One of the things that I'm a personal fan of is heroines from the Marvel universe. I'm a big Elektra fan. I'm a big Black Widow fan. And you guys gave it a shot a couple years ago, 2016, with Marvel Gems. And for whatever reason, that product just didn't quite resonate, either with collectors or whatever. Do you have some insight or some, you know, looking back, like maybe why, or if you had to do it all over again, what might be done different? And is there possible to give it another go in the future?
There's a lot of things that happened with Gems, because that was a product that I worked on as well, that I would like to correct, you know, looking back in hindsight, or, you know, if we ended up doing a volume two, so to speak. The big mistake with Gems that I feel is that the male characters, especially the popular ones, you were missing your Wolverine, you were missing your Captain America, you're missing your Spider-Man, etc. They were not present in that release. And, or let me rephrase, they had a very minimal presence. And when I say minimal, I'm talking maybe one out of 15 cases, so to speak. And so I think that us missing it or not including them in it and making it a female-centric product almost kind of handicapped us, so to speak. We didn't have those characters, and so the people that are, you know, they just collect Wolverine or they just collect Deadpool. I mean, that's totally fine. I think that's great. But there's no point for them to invest the time or energy into that set if their key character or their goal character is not there. There was a lot of stuff in there that I thought was great. One of the things that I'm particularly proud of out of that set was the Emma Frost collection. That had that glittery sort of substrate associated with it.
Yep.
That was personally one of my favorite inserts that I've done overall. It was just very disheartening to see that it was not received as well. But yeah, if we ever did a volume two going forward, I would love to include like a bunch of definitely the male characters or the male genre or the male side of the Marvel Universe.
Yeah, at least maybe storylines where those main characters have interacted with some of the heroines. I could see that, because I don't think you lose the whole female centric if you then just lump it all together. But I understand the need to probably include those. Would there? I was a little bit surprised that it was like packaged hit centric instead of packs. Do you think that might have resonated better with people if there was more to open a set, something like that to build?
Absolutely. I mean, it could have easily been similar to, let's say, something like Flare Ultra X-Men or Flare Ultra Spider-Man, where it's a 12-pack box with, you know, six cards in every pack type thing. What we were aiming for was a little bit more higher. We were aiming for a higher end product that was a little bit more than your standard release, but not as, you know, high end as like, say, Marvel Premiere or something. Something that's like, you know, $200 a box. You know, we always want to have that stepping stone, so to speak, to the next tier for our consumer. And that's what our goal was with Marvel Gems. If it came back again, like we did a volume two, I would absolutely re-examine the box content and the box structure. We would definitely take a look to see, all right, maybe it needs to be a 10 pack box with like three cards in every pack type thing.
Or I thought Marvel, the Doctor Strange was a really cool pack out concept with the three mini boxes. That seemed like you got something. There was real value there. Every box had something. I could see it working in that format as well.
And that's also a very viable option. I've been tinkering with that maneuver where it was the mini boxes and there was a one card pack, and basically every pack was a hit, for lack of a better term. You know, just about every full seven card box always had either an autograph or a sketch card in there, which a lot of the consumers, that's their main draw. And that may be a revisited option. It's just a question of, you know, can we find a vehicle that properly is able to hold that seven card pack setup?
Now, let me ask you this. I've always been curious about the process behind a non-movie product, because you mentioned the autographs and sketch cards. We've kind of sort of come to expect those in the movie-centered products. But when you're dealing with the other products, what's your process behind determining the hits, quote-unquote? You know, do you look at aftermarket prices on previous releases and see which ones did better? Or do you sort of try to create those aftermarket prices by your packouts, in a sense?
It's kind of a mix of both scenarios. So obviously there are certain mainstays in the Marvel universe, or I'm sorry, in the trading card universe, that transfer really well from a value perspective. So for instance, like the Jambalayas are always very well sought after. You know, the precious metal gems with their various tiers, always very well sought after. You know, I'll be the first to admit there are some ideas and inserts that I come up with that are not, you know, a grand slam home run. As far as coming up with the ideas, it's a lot of trial and error. You know, we try to always be a little bit different. You know, you can only print a character on a piece of, a cardstock so many times before people start getting bored with it. You know, what we try to do is make things new and original. So, for instance, one of the things we did, to go back to that Flare Ultra X-Men statement, is we have a new insert called Stacks. So what it is you're basically getting a layer of a card where the bottom layer is a standard card design, but there's two top layers that you need to track down as well that are on a clear acetate. And when you put all three of them together, you have the full complete card, the full color image, everything is assembled together.
That's awesome. When I saw it on the sell sheet, I'm like, man, leave it to Upper Deck once again to bring something that nobody's seen before. I mean, because, yeah, I can't wait to see one of them in hand, because just reading it, it's like, okay, I get it, but man, I can't wait to see one.
Yeah, it should be awesome.
Very cool. Thanks for that insight.
Yeah, no problem.
Yeah, absolutely. One of the things that I've always been curious about is, my goodness, the talent that you have at your disposal from a sketch artist standpoint has never been greater. It's just so popular right now. What involvement do you have directly with artists, or is that handled by somebody else?
It's technically handled by another department, but I have a lot of, I'll say, insight, or a lot of ideas in regards to what I'm looking for. You know, there's definitely a scale of artist caliber. You know, so you have people like, you know, Mick and Mac Leib, you have Malika Carr, you know, Anthony Tan is a personal favorite of mine, you know, that are on that plateau, so to speak. I always try to make sure that what goes into there's a almost like a bell curve of quality, so to speak. So you're going to have, you know, your guys that are not super amazing, you know, they're still good, but they're super amazing, or they're not super amazing, or they don't have a name associated with them. And then you have an average that goes upwards and then peaks and plateaus, and then it comes back down, and then you have these A-level guys that are blowing away phenomenal that sell for, you know, $500, $600, $700, $800 plus.
Awesome. One of the things I would like to, just real quick, while we're talking about sketch artists, Ivan, one of the things that I have personally found frustrating, and from our conversation, you can tell that I'm a pretty savvy guy when it comes to this stuff for the most part. But I mean, understandably, not one person can know really everything about, you know, Marvel Comics and the Marvel Universe. I would find it really helpful, and take this with a grain of salt as constructive criticism, when people do sketch cards, you know, it's easy to know who Captain America and Elektra are and things like that. But it would be nice to have the name of the character on every sketch card, mm-hmm. so that if you don't know a character, you know who it is. Because we had a great one from the Thor Ragnarok mm-hmm. product, and I mistook it for something else, and it kind of felt foolish.
Well,
but
just
knowing
that
it's an
I
art,
had to Google.
It's an artist interpretation. Yeah, yeah.
You know, to find out the character Ares, who's a little bit, you know, further off, but he looked like he could have been a Thor, you know, in a special
right,
costume.
Right, right, right. And knowing it's like, you know, an artist's interpretation of a character. So I would find it helpful if we could get names on the sketch cards. But you take it for what it's worth.
Oh yeah, no, I absolutely agree, because like we will have artists that will draw, you know, a character that made a one issue appearance in, you know, Amazing Spider-Man number 240 whatever, that no one's ever really heard of before. He just shows up, he does his thing, and then he disappears forever. But it's that artist's favorite character in the entire Marvel universe, and he has to draw it. You would be amazed at how many of those we get, of people being, like, even myself, like, I'll get them every once in a while, because I usually see just about every sketch card that comes through, and I'll look at it, and I'll be like, who is this guy again? And I literally have to go to, exactly what you guys did, I have to go to Google and track it down. We do.
Oh, I don't feel so bad now. I don't feel nearly so bad now.
I do have a great question from a fan, Matt. If you have a time, it actually goes along with that. But would Upper Deck ever consider doing an insert set of artwork submitted by fans?
There's a lot of extended red tape associated with something like that. That is an idea that I did pitch probably about maybe 3-odd years ago. It's not out of the realm of possibility. I don't like to try to exclude any ideas just for, you know, something may come along and I'm like, oh, this idea fits great with this product theme that we're going for. But I would say that it is definitely something that's worth having a greater conversation.
Yeah, I would imagine you got to get releases that once it's sent in, you own it, yada, yada, yada. Exactly. There's no compensation, blah, blah, yeah. But that would be cool. I mean, you know, fan art is such a hot thing, you know, right now. And it never ceases to amaze me. And I mean, if you go over to deviantart.com every once in a while and peruse what people are doing, you know, it's like, wow, you know. What else should we know about coming down the pipe from Upper Deck Entertainment Products in the next few months here?
So the after Flare Ultra X-Men, the next big release is going to be, it's probably going to be a race between either the 20th Century Fox property for Aliens, which is the second movie in the franchise, or it will be Avengers Infinity War, which I'm really looking forward to. We kind of went in a different direction with Infinity War, so it's not like similar to how we went a different direction with Doctor Strange. It's not going to be like your standard 5-card pack, 20-pack Fox type setup. I'm really excited to show off some of that stuff. I can't get into too much detail about it right now, but let's just say expect something different. The final big release out of the year will be towards the end of the year. 2018 Marvel Masterpieces featuring Simone Bianchi will be coming out. I want to say it's currently slated for, I want to say, end of Q3 of this year.
Awesome. Very cool.
One more just comment talking about potential cool hits from Seth Ward. How about relic cards that have panel cuts from original comic books? That seems like something I'm sure you must have considered already. It just makes so much sense, right?
I'll see you in Flare Ultra X-Men. I'll say that much.
Oh, there you go. Perfect, perfect. So you guys are... you're in tune with the pulse of collectors. We love
that's
that.
That's right.
All right. Well, now if you can get the screen used Infinity Stones embedded as relic cards, man, now you've hit a home run.
we tried to do that, but no one can handle that amount of power in a single hand.
Oh.
Well played, Matt. Well played. Listen, I've already taken more of your time than I said it was going to take, but I certainly hope that you'll join us again sometime, because this was a lot of
fun. Anytime, man. Just let me know. Be more than happy.
All right.
Thank you, Matt.
Appreciate it. You have a great night. Thank you for everything. And again, thanks for the support of the show, providing us with continued product to share with our audience. You guys are the best.
Thanks, Matt. Take care,
guys. See you, Matt.
Take care. Matt Rogers, Associate Product Development Manager for Upper Deck Entertainment Products.
Wow.
Great stuff.
How fun was that?
Yeah.
I hope we get to see him at the National and talk to him some more.
You know, it's so nice knowing that the person that builds these products gets it. You know, they're at heart, they're just like the rest of us. And that's what makes, I think, helps make those products really successful and a lot of fun to
even
do.
Better. So. I mean, I don't want to rank people, but better than me that he could pull out the exact favorite comic book that he had with the character and why, you know, and say the exact number. I'm not that good. I buy anthologies so I can get some good stories, but that was impressive.
I'm not that good. I'm not that good either. These people that quote issues, I'm just like, wow. Mm-hmm. the amount of space in your brain for that information is pretty impressive.
Well, how great is that, though? That's the guy making the cards. Like, that's who we want.
That's the guy making the cards. Exactly. Exactly.
Well, guess what? Upper Deck is. That's awesome.
Yep. Absolutely. So, good stuff. Good stuff. We've got Hot in the Shop coming up, Hobby Happenings coming up. Then we'll dive into some box breaks, Hot in the Shop, and we'll wrap things up. But, yeah, that was our first time talking to Matt. We've got a new friend of the program because that was just freaking awesome.
Oh, immediately. And if for whatever reason you only caught part of the interview, don't forget we are also on YouTube, and that interview will be up as its own segment on YouTube sometime pretty early tomorrow, probably by around noon or so, generally speaking. So make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel, GoGTS Live.
Awesome. All right, well, let's shift gears here and take a look at hobby stories in a segment that we like to call Hobby Happenings. And this week's Hobby Happenings include... Well, young MLB future stars are now 3-for-3 in securing the ball hit for their first big league home run. Well, you see, last weekend, Yankees call-up and top prospect Gleyber Torres joined Shohei Ohtani and Ronald Acuna with a win-win negotiation with the fan that retrieved his first home run ball. A young woman by the name of Tina caught the ball and brokered a deal with the Yankees security team. She received an autographed bat, a personalized ball inscribed, this was pretty cool, "Thanks, Tina, for catching my first home run ball."
That's cool.
And she and her friends were also treated to pictures with Torres, autographed baseballs of their own, and a behind-the-scenes tour of the Yankees clubhouse. What a fun time it was had by all, and congratulations to Mr. Gleyber Torres.
Yep, welcome to the bigs. Rob, collectors breaking boxes of Upper Deck's just released Black Panther trading cards, which we just talked about with Matt Rogers from Upper Deck, will be chasing the opportunity to own some of the rarest pieces of memorabilia from the Marvel Cinematic Universe. Company officials report that they have been given a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity to own the full production-used Black Panther suit from the blockbuster film.
What?
Yes. Yeah, the entire suit. The memorabilia cards will be awarded by redemption, and they will actually be found in three sizes as opposed to tiers: 5x7, 3x5, and standard 2.5x3.5 inch card size.
We need to get Matt back on.
Yeah, talk about that a little bit. Show us some pictures, because get this, Rob. Complete costume pieces will also be found included on these cards, such as a tooth from Black Panther's necklace and a full finger from Black Panther's glove. Now, will we find one of these gems when we break our box? That's the question. You'll have to stay tuned to a future episode.
That's very cool. Finds, we talk about this. You see, finding a few pre-war cards unexpectedly, it's a nice surprise and still happens from time to time at everything from yard sales to flea markets, home remodeling. However, stumbling across a few hundred, well, that doesn't happen every day or even every year for that matter. Finds like that do still happen, though, as evidenced by a Pennsylvania resident who recently bought a house adjacent to his property, an abandoned house, and upon exploration found quite the surprise of approximately 400 pre-war tobacco cards. While rummaging through left-behind boxes, the new owner discovered a cigar box overflowing with early 20th century cards. The box yielded almost 100 T206 cards, including cards from Hall of Famers Ty Cobb, Christy Mathewson, and Nap Lajoie, just to name a few. It also included a near-complete set of T227 Miners Extra, including the Cobb pictured here on the left. Cards from such sets as T205, W514, and 516 strip cards and American Caramels were also housed in the box. The owner has plans to sell the cards and is currently researching some options, including auctions, direct sale, or consignments. You know, Ivan, I really hope someday we do one of these stories and it's from one of our own viewers.
That would be fun. We're hoping one of you finds a find like this. Rob, moving into modern cards, the first recorded sale of a Shohei Ohtani red refractor chrome autograph, numbered to only 5 from 2018 Bowman, transpired last week, but you wouldn't have seen it on eBay, ComC, or anywhere else online. The sale of this card, as reported by Beckett's Ryan Cracknell, happened through good old-fashioned card show connections and some telephone correspondence. The card was originally pulled at the Mueller Cincinnati Card Show during the first weekend of Bowman's release. The dealer who sold the packs gave Nathan Burns, owner of Grand Slam Collectibles in Murfreesboro, Tennessee, a call to see if he knew anyone who might be interested. In turn, Burns worked his connections, contacting Adam Rowe, who he calls the biggest modern sports card buyer in the country and the guy with the most connections. Sorry, Rob, you're number 2 on the list. Sure enough, Rowe had a buyer. He and Burns split the deal's commission 50-50, and all's well that ends well. So you are probably wondering how much it sold for. Well, like a lot of private deals, you can't find that information on Watch Count. The buyer wanted to remain anonymous and the amount not disclosed. However, just this past Monday, a second red refractor numbered to 5 sold on eBay for $30,300. This was a stark contrast, however, to the sale of the same exact card for over $55,000 only a week earlier. The $55,000 card, however, was relisted after the original buyer canceled the sale. That one hurts.
Big time. Big time. Oh, that's like 25 grand. That's a lot of money.
Though they still got 25 grand, so also a lot of money.
Yes. Sandy Koufax, the legendary Dodgers pitcher, remains one of the game's most popular players from the golden age of baseball. This was evidenced by the recent sale of Koufax's game-worn jersey from the 1963 season. En route to beating the Yankees in the World Series that year and earning MVP honors, the Dodgers pitcher racked up 25 wins, was named the National League MVP, and became the first player to win the Cy Young Award by a unanimous vote. Given that season's spectacular performance, it's no surprise that the jersey garnered a sale of nearly $430,000 at Golden Auctions. What is surprising, however, is the sale of this check, signed by Koufax in 1984. With Koufax still alive and well living in Florida, and probably still writing a check here or there, one can only guess why someone paid the seemingly ridiculous sum of $11,000 for this piece.
Unreal.
Bizarre.
You may recall 2017 Topps Baseball Update featured mystery redemption cards featuring the best MVP seasons throughout MLB history. Topps has finally revealed the 12 mystery redemptions, as well as the commemorative Major League Baseball MVP autograph parallel set. The autograph redemptions in particular feature Chris Bryant, Buster Posey, and Bryce Harper.
More mystery redemption news. That's 2 weeks in a row. Well, have you ever wanted to be on TV? Well, now's your chance. A network based in Chicago called Decades issued a casting call looking for area collectors. A new TV show about memorabilia collectors is in the works, and they want to feature sports as a regular part of the show. So if you have a large or unique collection you think might be interesting to others and you live within an hour of the city, the producers would like to hear from you. Decades says that they'll have a as-yet-to-be-determined celebrity host for the series. You can email the production company to the email address on the screen with details about your collection, how long you've been collecting, how big it is, some of your favorite pieces, what makes your collection amazing, along with some pictures if you're so inclined. And good luck, and let us know if you get picked. And that's a look at this week's Hobby Happening. $11,000 for a check. Now, it is made out to the Major League Baseball Players Association. He won't ever be writing a check to them again, I would imagine.
Well, yeah, but unless you're a Donald Fear collector, do you really care?
Yeah, I guess. I mean, I was like, I don't get it. I really don't get it.
Rob, there was one thing, too, that I feel like we missed in Hobby Happenings, and I it was so big, I figured that you would touch on it, unless I'm just completely wrong. But I think for a long time we were calling LeBron James's $312,000 card the most expensive modern card sale, right?
Yeah, we were.
Well, did you see the sale of a card for more than that this past week?
I did not.
Well, I apologize. I didn't bring it to your attention. But it according to eBay and Watch Count, you can actually see it on my screen right now. The 2009 Bowman Draft Picks Chrome Prospects Super Fractors Mike Trout.
Oh, the Mike Trout
sold
yeah,
for $400,000.
I actually did see that. I did.
No
see
worries.
That.
I just I was like it was so quiet that I was like, did I just make this up? Is this not accurate? But you know, it did sell from Taiwan, so who knows? But
I'll tell you why I was aware of that story, and there is I'm waiting for Beckett and Ryan Cracknell to confirm that the sale has gone through. He was very explicit in the article that he's reached out to the seller. He's waiting to hear whether that sale has been completed. Mm. So you've actually stolen my thunder for one of next week's, hopefully, Hobby Happening segments. But we'll fill everybody in once we have confirmation that sale has gone through. Because, yeah, like I mean, lots of these sales or cards get sold. Mm-hmm. Do they get paid for is another story. So I was holding out before we called it the new champ of modern cards.
Well, I was curious, you know, because I saw it. And my actual question was, how do we know when that's confirmed? Similar to the Shohei Ohtani that was in the Hobby Happenings that sold for $55,000 and then immediately reappears and sells for half that. So
isn't it amazing?
But yeah.
All right.
Lots of crazy news today.
Absolutely. So let's take a look at some live box breaks. We've got DC's Legends of Tomorrow from Cryptozoic, and then highlights from that other box of Marvel Annual that we put off from last week. Topps Chrome UEFA Champions League Soccer cards. And, yep, we finally got our copy, 2018 Bowman Baseball cards. Did we find an Ohtani auto? You'll have to wait and see. For now, let's dive into a full box of Cryptozoic DC's Legends of Tomorrow.
So this box,
seasons 1 and 2.
24 packs in it, and I have not had the time or the pleasure to watch this show, but it looks super cool. I know that you do, right, Rob? You're into this?
Yeah, it's fun. It's fun.
And I can only imagine with all of the heroes in this show, as well as all of the villains and two seasons, what a packed product this is. Each box is going to deliver one autographed card and one memorabilia card. So I guess it's a guy named Rip Hunter and his motley team of heroes and villains traveling all across time to change a dark future and then to preserve the timeline. Because isn't that always the way it happens? You go and you're like trying to fix something.
Parallel.
And then you come back and everything is wrong because you fix the thing.
Each of the guys has an icon. I think this is Adam. Nope, Firestorm. Episodic stills from both season 1 and season 2. It skews a little heavy, I think, to season 1. As I was looking at all of the base card images.
Well, but you got to figure. Oh, you're saying the base, the 72 card base set.
Oh, right away. Look at that. We've got an inscribed auto of Kwesi Amayao as Dr. Midnight, wishing you all the best. That's
very
cool.
Very cool. Is that his catchphrase on
nice.
The show?
You know what? He only appeared in like one or two shows. I want to say. He's part of the Justice Society of America that they have some crossover with when they go back in time. So he's not a regular character. Sarah Lance, everybody knows her from Arrow. She was reincarnated and now is the captain of the Wave Rider, the ship that transports them through time. They fix anomalies as they occur on the timeline to keep everything in order. And time travel shows have become kind of, I don't want to say kitschy or passe, or there seems to be a lot of them after this show came out, and I still think they do it the best. That's just me, though. People might remember this guy from The Flash.
Let's say our autograph signer, Kwasi Amiya, is number 30,924 on the IMDb star meter. He was recently in 50 Shades Freed, as well as in the movie A Dog's Purpose.
Captain Cold.
Some of the other names in the set include Brandon Routh as Ray Palmer / The Atom. Arthur Darvill, of course, as Rip Hunter, and Sarah Gray as Stargirl. Neil McDonough as Damian Dark. I've always been a
Neil fan. He's great. He's great.
And of course, since it is Cryptozoic, there are collector's binders that you can get to house your set that are going to have an exclusive wardrobe.
Wow, look at that. You don't see that too often. That's never happened to us. A back-to-back base cards of the same
card. Ooh! Crypto collation! It has never happened to us in a Cryptozoic set. It's happened to us in plenty of 1988 baseball packs, right?
Brandon Routh is Dr. Ray
Stephanie
Palmer.
Carneliuson, a signer. Let me go check right now. Guess where I'm going to go check that, Rob?
GoGTS.net, yeah. Which has the full checklist. I do believe Stephanie Carneliuson is a signer.
Well, I can confirm that. Stephanie Carneliuson as Valentina Vostick is on the signature list. But for this and all of your checklist and collecting questions before you buy a new set, you can go to GoGTS.net and search Legends of Tomorrow or whatever other set you're opening. We have full product pages for pretty much every product that gets released to hobby shops.
Look at the Atom suit. Wouldn't you like to just, like, it fits in something the size of a cell phone. It's awesome. Yeah, they've gone to some pretty interesting places. 1920s, Chicago in the Capone era, the battlefields of World War I and Somme, France. The title card, always like to make sure you get that. It's one of the nice things about there. You usually get a base set or really close to it if there's not a collation error, which doesn't happen with Cryptozoic very often. Kendra Saunders as Hawk Girl. Rip Hunter, Time Master icon.
So do they actually bring in, like, the actual, like, Grant Gustin and the other star actors from the other shows on this too? Do they show up in this show?
Yeah, they did an awesome three-way crossover this year. Called Crisis on Earth X. It was fantastic. It's the power of the DC universe with the CW and Warner Brothers. They have that capability. Mm-hmm. They can tap into Supergirl, which is going to be coming from them very, very soon. One of those parallels with the icon stamp on it, not just the foil up there. There's the Atom icon.
I'm also curious if any of our viewers, we did touch on it in Hobby Happenings, are any of you within an hour of Chicago and have a collection that you think would fit?
I know
that
some people that we've sent winning cards to are, so I definitely know that people are. That'd be pretty cool. Feature one of our audience members. That'd be sweet. Hawkman and Hawkgirl icon. lots of gadgets on this show, lots of unique history, as you can see just from the costumes on this show alone are worth an Emmy. Couple packs left. Do we get a auto and a relic, or just one or the other?
One autograph and one memorabilia card, so keep hunting, Rob.
Okay. I've only got a couple packs left. Ooh, I got one of the puzzle cards. That's going to be tough to finish. It's the first one of those. That was Z7, so I imagine there's probably 9 cards to make the puzzle. Definitely going to have to get more than one box if you want to do that.
Yeah, they didn't mention that in the chase sets, just character bios, legendary objects, and icons. So.
Yeah, here's another one. Okay.
Looks like some more fun stuff from Cryptozoic. They like to surprise us with some things that aren't on the sell sheet sometimes.
Yeah, like those stamped parallels. Yeah. They were not on the sell sheet.
And the star power cards as well, when they first debuted those.
We've pulled a couple of those now, haven't we?
So,
two packs. This is the next to last pack, excuse me.
Also, if you're new to the show, or if you're not new to the show, we do have our big May Stravaganza prize pack giveaway. I believe...
Did I do good with that one?
Yeah, you did fantastic. Lots of crazy good stuff in there.
It's in here.
Can feel it?
Nice. It's a Damian Dark.
Ooh, there
Neil
we
McDonough.
Go.
All right, so we'll give that and the auto away.
All right.
Very cool. Very cool. Yeah, he's a good actor.
You want to like Neil McDonough even more, Rob? He actually plays hockey.
Yeah, sure. Oh, that is, it does make me like him.
I knew it would. You with your Stanley Cup season. No, he's part of the celebrity hockey players sort of circle here in Hollywood.
That's cool.
All right.
Clean up this a little
so
bit
So while
here.
Rob gets that cleaned up, the ways that you enter to win. You got to go to twitter.com/GoGTSLive. No matter what channel you're watching on, that's where we get you guys entered to win. You have to retweet a tweet that's going to be up in just a few minutes that has the cards and pretty much says that same thing. Retweet this tweet and make sure you're watching live to win. We don't announce the winners until the end of the show, and it's your job to claim your winning cards. If they don't get claimed, they go back into the prize bucket for next week. And don't forget to retweet that pinned tweet as well with the Periscope, the live Periscope broadcast, so that everybody that you know can see the show. You know, we get these boxes from the manufacturers because of the fact that you engage the manufacturers. So the more people engage, the more boxes, the better boxes we'll get. We're still waiting on a box of Immaculate, right, Rob? Isn't that the big dream?
Or Flawless. Yeah. Last week we had an opportunity to break and look at a full box of Marvel Annual. We also gave away a sealed box. We have a third box here, but since we took a look at all the cards in all 20 packs last week, we're going to hit some highlights from this box.
Also, did I see that the winner opened the box and shared their hits and tagged us in it?
You'd be better at catching
that than I would.
Or was that the Prisms,
the World Cup Prisms?
So here are the Secret Empire cards. Mighty Captain Marvel.
And Rob, since we needed something for the Periscope tweet, can we just do the hits from this as the Periscope tweet, since we're doing just a recap, not an open?
Sure.
All right, cool. And if you weren't watching last week, there's one sketch or manufactured patch card per box, as well as one purple foil parallel.
And so here's the blue parallels. You can see they have the blue foil on the name and then that bordering.
And this set is specifically designed for collectors and fans of Marvel Comics, as our guest Matt Rogers stated. It highlights...
Yeah, kind of recaps,
yeah,
right?
It highlights the key events and characters from the past year, specifically, of Marvel publications. So it's not just a Marvel trading card set, it's the essentially the Marvel 2017 story in trading card form.
And our purple parallel was my youngest daughter's favorite Marvel character, Hawkeye.
Oh, that's awesome. What did he do this year? Does it say on the back?
Yes, it does. Let's see. Hawkeye went on trial for killing Bruce Banner after shooting him through the head with a special arrow.
Whoa! Wait, what happened?
See what happens when you don't read?
That's crazier. That's crazier than Mike putting a bounty on Daredevil.
Spoiler alert!
Remember last week we found out that Mike put a bounty out on Daredevil? Yeah. This week Hawkeye's killing Hulk? What?
Marvel top 10. Everything from story arcs to issues to villains to heroes and fights. It's a cool insert. Top 10. So there must be probably like, I would imagine there's 10 for heroes, 10 for issues. And our last pack, we hit this card last week, Rookie Heroes, Ironheart. In memoriam, Cyclops.
He died too?
Cyclops.
Oh my God. What's going on?
You know, Ivan, I mean, it's comic books. No one ever really dies, right?
Yeah.
And we got a one-of-one sketch card in this box.
Oh, of Dead Man. I mean, Cyclops. That's a good-looking one. Full color.
Okay.
What does it say up there at the top?
I just noticed that, too. It just so you know, this is... the artist is Jose Ventura.
Signed by him on the back. I love it.
And not only that, but I really like that he printed his name, too. Because I should have said to Matt, too, you know what? They need to print the artist's name. Because a lot of times we've... And put their Twitter handle. Good point, James. Because a lot of times they sign it and we don't know who the artist is because we don't know that. You know, if you don't know their art and know their signature.
Mm-hmm.
So it was cool that Jose put that there. Now, back to what is on the front here. Let's see. I'm going to actually tilt the camera.
It's like I'm watching the Bourne Identity.
It says, after Mark Susso? So I don't know what that means.
Hmm. Interesting.
All right.
Maybe Mark Susso is another artist and somebody had to give themselves a little reminder of where these went in the collation.
I guess maybe. so you got a little bonus on there, a little production.
Yeah. But very
right.
cool.
So that's
card.
Very cool. Yeah.
And awesome of the artist, as you mentioned, to sign his name on the back. So if you... So are we giving away all the hits or just the sketch is one and then the hits
we'll
is
give
the
away,
other?
Yeah, we're going to give away the sketch card
okay.
like we did last week, the big
okay.
hit.
Well, I had said retweet the Periscope for that, but I feel bad. I feel like we should find Jose Ventura and tag him or something. So... Okay, so I guess there is a tweet with the photo. So follow that, and Rob, will you be able to find something for everyone that helps share the Periscope?
No. All right.
I'll pick a hit from one of our boxes when we have multiple hits. Do we have any boxes? Oh, we might not. It's not a jumbo of Bowman, is it?
No.
Okay, well, then I'm sorry. I'm a jerk, but we give away enough free stuff on the show, so be happy, and thank you for retweeting the Periscope. go enter the prize pack, the online prize pack. Where is that link, anyways? Is it on the Instagram right now, or they all show links, James? The prize pack link, is it? Did you switch the Instagram?
It's on there.
Okay, so it's all show links right now, but that means you got to follow us on social media so that when it gets switched back, you can find it. So, moving on to the Topps UEFA Champions League Chrome.
This is a 2017-18 product. I don't know what it... I mean, does the Champions League carry over from one year to the next, like basketball and hockey do, or is this just like to mash up 2 years into one product? Not sure. So
yeah, I'm not entirely sure either, because you know me and UEFA, we're not on the same terms that me and the Melis are, me and MLS. But that said, Topps has been doing a great job producing these cards, and this is the first time ever that the Topps Chrome brand will showcase the greatest stars of the UEFA Champions League. Rob, we are expecting at least one autographed card, because there's one autograph in every box.
And plenty of shiny cards. Here's Neymar, a refractor. Ooh. We've got lots of refractors. Romula Lukaku.
Oh, wait, UEFA, that's like the European League. That's what we're talking about. So it's
the Champions League, yeah.
Because Lionel Messi is in this product.
Conte, yeah, Ronaldo, Kane, all those guys. Caleb McGregor, Ter Sturgeon, that guy. And then there's a really fun insert called Lightning Strike. And we hit some big hitters in this one. James Rodriguez, Luis Suarez.
Also, keep an eye out.
Thomas Mueller.
You had a Neymar Jr. just a minute ago, right?
Yep.
So there are five cards on the checklist with image variations. Messi, Pulisic, Neymar Jr., Harry Kane, and Cristiano Ronaldo. So if you see any of those names, I'm gonna Google search the Neymar Jr. Topps Chrome right now, because I did see that when it came up.
The other insert set, Future Stars, which is pretty cool that they busted that out for a little... hockey action, or a little soccer action, is fun. We're hearing from our producer that the season does overlap. Okay, so that makes sense.
Rob, I think that might have been the Neymar SP. That is a $250 card? $50 card.
This
one? Neymar. Show me that again. Show me that too. Yeah. Yeah, that's the SP version.
Get out!
Well, one guy has it for 50, another guy has it for 50.
Cool, we'll give it away.
Yeah, it's a SP variation. The base card has him running, not smiling.
There's Paulo Diabla.
Your luck with soccer, man.
Harry Kane. Future star.
I wonder what the odds are on these base card image variations.
Check this out. We got a number to 250. Purple refractor of Sergio Aguero. And, drumroll please, our autograph is of Trent Alexander-Arnold. Trent Alexander-Arnold.
For Liverpool.
So we will give both that and the Neymar away for sure. All right. And last but not least, hold on to your shorts. We have the ever-popular 2018 Bowman Baseball, a hobby box with one autograph per box. And we will look at the highlights of this as well.
Looks like Trent Alexander's nothing to shake a head at either. A good $25-$30 auto there. So that was a pretty dang nice. Good box.
Awesome. So we found lots of your key RCs in this box. Here's Francisco Mea, who is this week's Future Watch player profile.
Wait, did you already,
on GoGTS.net.
You already opened the packs?
Yeah, this is highlights.
Oh, man.
It's on the show notes. I said it three times.
I've been writing
Reese
stuff
Hoskins.
It's not on the show.
Willie Calhoun.
Oh, there it is on the show.
Clint Frazier. Ozzie Albies. Is that right?
Albies.
I know he's Albies. Yeah. Dude is just super hot right now. Ahmed Rosario. I mean, when I said we got all the good ones, Alex Verdugo. Victor Robles. Oh, there he is. Shohei Ohtani.
Hey. Is that on the giveaway pile?
Sure. In fact,
how about I give that away to somebody that retweeted the Periscope? Hey, there you go. Periscope Ohtani. So see, I am not a, what's the PC term for that, Rob?
I don't think there is one, but check this out. We got a Chrome prospect of Ronald Acuna. Mm-hmm.
Would it be too much to put
and in? Gleyber Torres? So ooh, we haven't even gotten to the auto yet, and have already on fire with this box. Bowman Sterling, an insert this year. Bryce Harper, unique insert. Talent pipeline. I love theme inserts. Three players, same team. Don't like it when they put three different players from three different teams, because I don't want it if it's got my guy on it and somebody else's. But this is for the team collector for sure right there. And then another one of those for the Orioles. And then the always popular Bowman Scouts Top 100. Mm. Dane Dunning. Ian Anderson. Walker Buehler.
Hot Walker Buehler. He's on fire right
Anthony
now.
Alford. Hunter Green. And Ryan McMahon. More inserts. This one is the Bowman Trending. Fernando Tatis Jr.
Ooh, I know some people that think that he's God. That's how hot he is.
Steven Gonsalves. Franklin Perez. And Scott Kingery.
Hey, there's another hot one. I just got tickets to see the Phillies play the Dodgers.
Okay. Oh, nice. Good for you. Bowman Birthdays. This is, I don't even think this was on the sell sheet. I really honestly don't remember if it was. Byron Buxton. Matt Chapman. Tyler Glasnow. All right, now this next subset, it's an insert, actually. Rookie of the Year favorites. Nick Williams.
Ooh, that's a shiny, cool parallel.
Jack Flaherty. I don't know about them being Rookie of the Year favorites. Here's one, Rafael Devers.
Now, I thought he wasn't eligible. Cool. I thought he played too much last
year. I didn't think
so
either.
Maybe it really is Roy's favorites. Maybe some guy named Roy works at Bowman.
Now, this one's got all of our super shiny and numbered cards. We got a purple parallel numbered to 250 of Hunter Renfro. We got a purple number to 250 paper of Gleyber Torres.
Ooh, that's a hot one.
Yeah. We got Jorge Onya. Is that the atomic right there?
It looks atomic. Is it numbered on the back?
It is not. So,
well, I'm watching the Periscope and the Facebook comments. Someone tell us.
TJ Zuch number to 499. How about a gold parallel number to 50 of D.L. Hall?
Oh, it had to be a pitcher.
How about a orange parallel number to 25?
Chrome or paper?
Chrome. Oh. Talent pipeline for the Royals.
That's a sick card. That's sick.
And then it's not an Ohtani, but I'm calling it a boom anyway. It's Luis Escobar number to 25.
Oh, wow.
Now, what I was going to do, Ivan,
yes, It's not in the show.
Is nope. So that is all right. So the auto, the Otani, and then let's go ahead and give away that whole stack to a third winner.
The whole stack.
The whole stack.
Like number to 25 and the number to 50.
Yep.
Wow. Can I be the winner?
No.
So the first Luis Escobars, there have been like four of them that have sold, each of them for over 100.
Congratulations to whoever wins that.
Like seven of them. Lots of that orange refractor has been popular. But wow, amazing. So again, to enter to win, go to Twitter and go GTS Live and retweet the tweets with the card hits, as well as our Periscope pinned tweet at the top. Wow, the entire stack of Bowman refractors and numbereds. That's unreal.
And inserts and paper rookies. Everything.
Wow. Very fun, especially when you factor in that this is selling for, what, 170 a box right now and $370 for a jumbo, $380 or something for a jumbo. So if you've been sad that you didn't feel like you had access to this product, well, watch GoGTS Live, and you've got a chance to get some hits from it, right?
That's right.
I honestly think that Gold Royals pipeline, like, I love the fact that this year we've both complained about in the past them putting different team players on the same card. And this pipeline where it's single A, double A, and triple A guy from each of them that has a...
Isn't that awesome? I love that. It. That's a great, great insert.
And then to get a gold parallel, that's pretty, pretty cool.
Orange.
Yeah, orange. Sorry.
25.
They're so shiny. We got a gold parallel, too.
They're so shiny.
Yeah. I got to think this Luis Escobar kid must be something that his, you know, because pitchers, they're not always the hottest prospect cards. He's 21 years old. 6'2", 204 pounds. That's a good size, and he's brand new. Just joined him in 2017. 3.86.
240.
ERA.
Did you say 240?
No.
He's beat.
No,
oh.
204.
Oh, okay. I was going to say beefy.
He's got five saves in six games. Oh, no, it's five starts. GS. 1.19 whip. Is that good?
Yeah. Pretty good.
So, someone to keep an eye on. Well, that was really fun, Rob.
Well, thank you, Ivan. Well,
I think a lot of people had fun.
All right. Well, let's shift gears and look at, we've taken a look at what's kind of some hot products right now. Let's look at what are going to be some hot products next week with a brand new episode of Hot in the Shop, or segment rather. Got to get mine queued up here. All right. First up, we have a brand new hockey product releasing next week in the form of SP Authentic Hockey. That's right. Future Watch autograph cards. And with this, some heavy hitters in the top part of the draft. And Hischier, it's going to be fun. So you get one of those in every box. An additional autograph card. A Spectrum FX Future Watch insert card, and then four Upper Deck Update insert cards. That additional autograph card I mentioned, that could be anything from Sign of the Times, Marks of Distinction, Immortal Ink, or other classic favorites. And in addition, look for autograph patch cards as well, some of which are going to come in Future Watch versions. So that's cool. In addition, according to my notes here, you're going to get at least one Spectrum FX Future Watch insert card. And then in addition, those FX Future Watch cards come in different tiers, Tier 2 and Tier 3, and those will deliver at least two hits per inner case. New this year, how about Connor McDavid buyback autograph Young Guns cards? Yeah, that's really exciting. And in addition, we've told you in the past about Upper Deck's Bounty Program. Well, the Bounty Program returns with some amazing achievement cards numbered to 50. So collectors will be rewarded for finishing their collection first. Be sure to check out the Upper Deck website for more information about the bounty program if it's something that you are not familiar with. Because if you're a set collector and a set builder, this is definitely going to be something up your alley because they reward you for building sets. This product will release next Wednesday, and it's good, as always. I can just tell. 16 boxes, 18 packs, 5 cards, 2 8-count count enters. Next Wednesday in hobby shops everywhere. SP Authentic Hockey.
Rob, if you didn't get enough baseball already this season, well, you're going to have a fun one with 2018 Super Break Baseball Super Packs. That's right. Super Break is back with a pack product. This is going to deliver 1 to 6 premium buyback or cut signature baseball cards in every pack. The packs, again, sold individually. Very limited production. So look at this at your favorite breaker and ask your favorite hobby shop for this. It's going to be hard to find. What is it, though? What is Super Break Baseball? Well, this is a repack buyback product of cards, generally graded. A lot of them are graded. It's essentially your chance to get some hits that none of us could ever afford. If you look at that picture, it's tough to see. Zoom in. That is the Super Fractor, an X Fractor, which I believe were numbered to 10, of Clayton Kershaw autograph from his rookie year in Beckett. Yu Darvish rookie autograph, BGS 9.5. Yasiel Puig, Bowman Chrome Blue Wave refractor. Tons of cards like that. Hall of Famers, fan favorites, parallels, cut signatures, chrome, metal, and prism cards, top rookie cards, and the graded buybacks in every pack. So this is a really cool, fun one to chase if you're looking for those cards that you know you could never afford on eBay, but you're willing to go in for a pack or two. It's going to be fun to rip in the hobby shop or through your favorite group breaker, and that is going to be out on 5/15 this month, next week.
Awesome. If you are a fan of the golden age of Hollywood, and really who isn't, or you should be, you got to check out 2018 Historic Autographs Celebrity Vintage. This is going to deliver 2 encapsulated cut signature cards in every box. It's really a throwback to the stars of film, TV, and music from the first 60 years. And it also includes a few modern stars to chase as well. Extremely short printed. There are 10 boxes in a case and only 76 total cases produced. 2 cards per box. All cases are hand numbered and every cut signature is authenticated by Beckett Authentication Services. Some of the names you'll be looking for are greats like Buster Keaton, Elizabeth Taylor, Charles Bronson, Christopher Reeve, Bela Lugosi, Jerry Lewis, one of my all-time favorites, Marlene Dietrich, George C. Scott, Frank Sinatra, Marlon Brando, Al Pacino's in here, Betty White, Betty Davis, Cole Porter, Doris Day, Robert Duvall, Duke Ellington, Ed Sullivan, awesome, Jack Benny, John Barrymore, Mae West, Milton Berle, Mammy Van Doren, Will Rogers Jr., and many, many more. This will be in stores next week as well. If your hobby shop doesn't order historic autograph products, you might want to check them out. They make some really fun, unique products. Historic Autographs Celebrity Vintage.
And finally, also hitting shops on Wednesday, if you need more baseball, physical baseball, this is the product for you. TriStar Hidden Treasures New York Dynasty Autographed Baseballs. Each case, so if you buy into breaks, this is important, is going to deliver 12 autographed baseballs featuring the New York Yankees greats from the franchise's storied past, the recent dynasty, and its future stars. Of course, what are we hunting for here, Rob? A grand treasure, a multi-signed ball of Yankee legends Babe Ruth and Lou Gehrig, along with other 1930...
Those guys are good! Players.
They are. I mean, I hear that Babe Ruth is the new Shohei Ohtani. Now, remember, one of the other fun things that TriStar does is that each case is going to have one 24-karat gold autographed baseball numbered to 12 or less. So if you want to look at the checklist and do the math, you'll see how allocated this product is. It's a hard product to find. So New York fans, hunt it down. Baseball fans, hunt it down. The mix of Yankee greats includes names like, oh, if Babe Ruth and Lou Gehrig isn't enough for you, Mickey Mantle, Joe DiMaggio, Yogi Berra.
Those guys are good.
Yeah, I hear Yogi Berra is the new, is the old.
Wilson Contreras.
What? He doesn't have quips,
I don't know.
Does he? Does Wilson Contreras have quips? Don Larson, George Steinbrenner. So some names that just rotate around the Yankees, not just players. Derek Jeter, Giancarlo Stanton, Aaron Judge, Paul O'Neill, and more. Every baseball is hologram numbered to 36 or less. Remember, that's or less. Doesn't mean there's 36 Mickey Mantle baseballs in this product. That would be unreal. You can also find randomly inserted Dynasty tickets, so there are a few exceptions to the baseball rule. These are redeemable for full-size authenticated New York Yankees memorabilia, including Don Larson signed 16x20 photograph with an inscribed story, a Mariano Rivera autographed 16x20 photograph, a Joe DiMaggio signed check, and a Dave Righetti autographed jersey. And again, Rob, that grand treasure, the autographed baseball of Babe Ruth and Lou Gehrig, along with some other 1930 awesome. Yankees players. Incredibly rare.
That's awesome.
Incredibly allocated product here. So keep an eye out for it, and especially if you're a Yankees fan, let us know at twitter.com/GoGTSLive if you buy into any breaks so that we can keep an eye out for them and see what it is that you hit. That's in shops Wednesday.
Awesome. Very cool. And that wraps it up for Hot in the Shop, short and sweet. Sometimes it's a matter of quality and not quantity, and a little bit of something for everybody there next week.
I love it.
All right. I think we have some housekeeping to do in the form of letting our good friends and viewers out there in TV land know what they won.
Yes.
And who
yes.
won.
We do. We do need to do that.
All right, I'll grab my stack of stuff
wink,
here.
Wink, wink, nudge, nudge. Buy time.
All right.
Tell people
so
things.
So this week, you were Johnny on the spot last week.
We had a video, remember?
It was like a minute long. Wow.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So one of the things I wanted to tell you from a programming notes standpoint is pay attention to our web presence next week, because Ivan and James are going to the NFLPA rookie premiere photo shoot, GTS Customer Appreciation Day. They will both be there. Look for video from them, tweets from them about the happenings. This is a very fun event for GTS customers who get to go and interact with some of the top draft picks. Players have not been announced yet, so it's going to be a surprise for everybody. Because it's local, the guys have said that they're going to be able to get back to the show on time. And we are going to bring James on camera. And James and Ivan are going to give us a complete rundown of what transpired at day's festivities.
As much of a rundown as we can of what happens behind the curtain. Because what happens in the Beverly Hilton stays in.
Sometimes stays in the Beverly Hilton. We get it. But no, you did a great job last year, and with James joining you this year, I imagine it's going to be even better than ever. So that'll be fun. Wow, Jets up 3-1 in the third. Holy cow. Let us know what you think of the new spokesperson for GoGTS Weekly, our video recap of everything that's happened on GoGTS.net. We're pleased to be welcome to part of the team, Miranda Parnum. She's awesome. She's done a great job and is having a lot of fun doing this. And she brings you your weekly recap of hobby news every Friday. How do you get that in your inbox? You go to GoGTS.net, you go to the right sidebar, and you subscribe to the Hobby Wire. We won't spam you. You'll get two emails every week. One's a list of the new product releases. The other one's a recap of everything posted on the blog for that week.
Not to mention,
one-stop shopping.
Subscribing to the Hobby Wire is one way to get 25 bonus entries in our prize pack. So we'll make sure we tweet out.
Why would you not do that? Yeah, why would you not do that?
No reason not to. That said, if you like winning, well, hopefully you're still watching. Hopefully you haven't gone anywhere because we have winners for you.
Let's do it.
All right, so let's start off at the very top of the Legends of Tomorrow, Cryptozoic. First off, we have the relic card of Neil McDonough, popular actor, Minority Report, awesome guy. That's going to a new winner, Quentin Reese. Quentin Reese. So, Quentin, how do you win? Well, you have to email us to claim your prize. GoGTS Live, the name of the show, at GoGTS.net. The name of the website. So remember, you go to GoGTSnet.net to get your product information, your reviews, your future watch, your rookies columns, your interviews, and you watch GoGTS Live for fun stuff like this. All right, easy enough. That's the website. That's what you need to email. Email us your mailing address and what you won to make it easy on us. And from there, we have the next one is the autograph, Kwesi Amia. Kwesi Amia, Dr. Midnight. That's going to Sid Tumbokin. Congratulations, Sid. Thank you for tuning in and watching. All right, switching universi to Marvel. We have the sketch card from Marvel Annual, Cyclops, in memoriam. Rest in peace, Cyclops. Apparently he died last year. That's going to James Campanos. Congratulations, James. Thanks for watching. Next up, so Rob, which is bigger, the autograph or the name RSP? Well, which one's in your right hand?
The Neymar is the bigger one, and the auto is the one I have.
Okay,
right,
perfect.
Here.
Well, the auto of Trent Alexander-Arnold is going to Alex Oy. Congratulations, Alex. Good to see you watching the program again. And then the Neymar Jr. SP hot card, something that we may not have seen if it wasn't for the checklist on GoGTS.net. That's why it's so useful. That's going to Harold Denny. Congratulations, Harold. All right, next up we have the stack of Bowman hits minus the Shohei Ohtani. You did pull that one out, right? Okay,
yep.
Perfect. So that stack of Bowman hits is going to Dan Swinson. Congratulations, Dan. Welcome to the show in the winner's circle. The Periscope tweet of the Shohei Ohtani goes to Jeffrey Groton. Congratulations, Jeffrey. Thank you for watching. And then finally, the Luis Escobar auto, the pitcher for the Pittsburgh Pirates farm system, numbered to 25, an orange refractor, jazzy boom like I've never seen before, goes to one Mike Buzzard. Congratulations, Mike. So thank you, everyone, for watching. It was a fun show tonight. It was tight. We got some great insight on Marvel and Upper Deck. Don't forget to tune in all week long to social media for ways to win, and then on Thursday for the NFLPA rookie premiere. And Rob, I do feel like we should start mentioning the Nationals only like 2 months away. People need to know about
that. Yeah, after,
right?
I know, after the NFLPA, we'll be in full national mode, and I've already got some fun stuff planned for people in attendance that stop by the main stage.
Yeah. So make sure you follow at NSCC Show on Twitter as well.
Absolutely. Special thank you to Matt Rogers from Upper Deck for joining us last minute tonight, as well as the manufacturers who provided product for breaks and giveaways, including Upper Deck, Topps, Cryptozoic. And we'll be back with a brand new show next week, recapping the NFLPA GTS Customer Appreciation Event Day, which is a lot of fun. And special thanks, as always, to Executive Producer Joe Fallon,
thanks, Joe.
Associate Producer The Asset, James Gale. For that guy over there, Ivan Lovegren, I'm Rob Bertrand. You guys know what to do. Have a great weekend. Always be collecting. We'll be back same time, same day next week. Have a good one.